Welcome back, geology fans. When we looked at relative age dating, we saw a lot of cross-sections. It is as if you cut the earth like a cake to reveal all the layers down below. Then the cross-cutting relationships and superposition became so much more apparent. Occasionally, we get fantastic road cuts or cliffs and canyons that can come close to what we see in these illustrated cross-sections. But not all cross-sections we see in the geologic literature, including those produced with William Smith's first geologic map of England, come from such great exposure. And there's a good chance there won't be such great exposure in your field area. And yet you want to get one of these illustrated cross-sections for your field area. How do you produce one that will be accurate, meaningful, and enlightening? It starts in those preliminary investigations before getting into your field site, as with so many of these exercises. When you were going to the big picture scale of aerial photos, satellite images, or Google Earth, you determined the grain of your area. What transects across the landscape would go parallel to the beds of rock, following the contacts, perhaps? And which ones will cut across the grain, hitting the beds and contacts at right angles, perpendicularly? It's the latter, the transects cutting perpendicular across the grain, that will be your best bet for producing a good cross-section. Look for a place where you can walk a relatively straight line across all the relevant beds you wish to explore, where the bedrock is relatively well exposed, and you can actually walk with no cliffs, fences, private property issues you haven't resolved. The transect you choose may be revised once you have boots on the ground and can face all the possibilities. Unless you see a good reason, such as wanting to end up on one end of your field site, there is nothing to dictate which way you walk this line once in the field. The most common designations for endpoints of these lines are A to A prime or B to B prime, X to X prime or Y to Y prime. A, B, and C, and X, Y, and Z are the most common letters I've seen used. But for simplicity, I'll talk about A to A prime in this episode. Anyway, you can walk from A to A prime or A prime to A. It's up to you, but we usually try to go A to A prime. To prepare further, start to make your cross-section illustration by first making a topographic profile across the A to A prime line, making it at a scale that fits across the length of your page with enough room left for a legend, far enough up the page to allow for a title above and perhaps to project certain structures above the surface, but more room for at least a 1-to-1 ratio of the rock that you want to project below the surface. Bring this cross-section skeleton with you into the field, in your map board materials, and when you are committed to walking your A to A prime line, have it at the ready. Every time you get strike and dip, you can identify the rock formation, perhaps with help from the strat column you made before. You will note it on your cross-section and be focused on the contacts between formations. A direct strike and dip on a contact is gold, but often you get strike and dip on either side of a contact, and it is easy to infer that if the measurements on either side of the contact are the same, then the contact between them is also at that strike and dip. And you place a small leader line from the topographic profile surface down in the direction the contact is dipping. But here we must be careful. Let's say your A to A prime line is perfectly perpendicular to the beds and contacts between them. Then easy peasy, the dip of the beds and contacts are the exact angle of the leader line you draw down from the surface. But if you hit these planar features at any angle other than straight 90 degrees perpendicular, and even if you design your transect line to cross perpendicular across the beds, you might hit other planar features like faults, which may not be perpendicular to the transect. And so we need to know how to put the apparent dip angle, which will always be equal to or less than the actual dip angle of the feature. It is equal to at 90 degrees transect and gets smaller with any more acute angle. There are lookup tables like this one from Compton's highly recommended book, Geology in the Field. Just if you have the first edition, make sure to correct the 35.5 to 34.5. Or you can use a linear graph like this to figure out apparent dip, or there's these circular calculators for dip angle. But a copy of this lookup table on your phone or in your field notebook, that's handy. You can also calculate this directly if you want. In episode 71, where we saw strike and dip details, we examined this concept of apparent dip and gave these formulas to play with. What we really want in this formula is dA, as that is the apparent dip. We have measured the true dip, dt, and we know the acute angle between our transect and the strike of the planar feature, which is sxs minus sb in our formula. Which more exactly is the azimuth bearing of the strike of the planar feature minus the azimuth bearing of the transect we are taking? So we have all we need to calculate apparent dip from dA equals A tan, tan dt times sine of the angle between our transect and the strike and dip of the feature. Here's that lookup table again, which is really handy for a quicker solution right away in the field. It's rounded off to half a degree because you're never going to get more precise than that anyways. Now that you have the apparent dip of the feature, you can put the leader line down from your topographic profile at the correct perspective angle. Continue across your transect, marking all such contacts, faults, fold axes, etc., that will project below ground. I mean, joints will not be as important for this, as they don't displace any features below ground like faults do. Once you have all your leader lines plotted, you can begin to project the beds and features below ground. Think about cross-cutting relationships and plot faults that cut through your other beds first. If you draw the beds first, down below the surface, then project the fault across them, you will have to correct for fault displacement. So draw the fault first, and then the features cut by the fault after that. When drawing the faults, it is not wise to simply project the fault straight line down to the center of the earth for all eternity. Due to the elasticity of rocks, faults often diminish to no movement or even ductile features at depth. So it's often wise to dash the lower parts of faults unless you have more information, such as tendency to curved Lystric faults. As for drawing the contacts of the rock formations down, remember beds should maintain uniform thickness unless known to do otherwise. Conservation of mass, people. This is an impossible cross-section of no planet in this universe. Yuck. Keep uniform thickness even as rocks may get faulted or folded. If you find a rock body is getting pinched out or bloating, you may have made an error somewhere and need to go back and try again. Color in your final illustration using the same colors for rock formations you are using on your map. Be sure to fully label your cross-section with a title, the author, and date, a key, and note the direction of each end of your transect. If your A to A prime line goes northeast to southwest, then put a northeast by the A side of your line, perhaps with an exact azimuth trend, and southwest by the A prime side of the line. Make sure the scale is present and a note of any vertical exaggeration you use, even if it is 1:1. And there you have it. Your cross-section is a beautiful work of informative art, which you can apply your relative age dating rules to more easily and begin to unravel the full geologic history of the area. When we come back next time, I'm going to congeal all of our previous episodes into an actual field example as we explore the geology of the area around the town of Morrison, Colorado, just south of the Red Rocks Amphitheater, a hop, skip, and a jump south of the Colorado School of Mines. Here on Earth Explorations.